Hello friends, so let us embark upon this very high yield topic, and that is COVID-19 radiology imaging findings and spectrum. Now remember that as you are in your final stage of preparation, especially when you prepare for central institute exams like AIIMS, PGI, JIPMER, it is very important to stay update regarding the recent topics or recent trends that are prevalent at that particular time. Now, especially when we are facing this severe pandemic of COVID-19 disease, it is very highly likely that maybe in the next few exams that you're going to face, you will come across a few questions about this particular topic. As far as radiology is concerned, I'm going to deal with the imaging spectrum that you would come across in COVID-19 disease. What could be the potential MCQs that could be asked? So we are going to have a detailed comprehensive discussion here. Now, what is the etiological agent? As we all know, COVID-19 is the terminology which is coined for coronavirus disease 2019 because it emerged or started in the year 2019. It is the etiological agent, causative agent, is a severe acute respiratory syndrome, that is SARS coronavirus type 2. So that is the strain of the virus. Now, what is the investigation of choice? If they ask you for COVID-19 disease, the investigation of choice is a reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction, RT-PCR, which is done on either a nasopharyngeal or a throat swab. Right? This is something that you will study more in your microbiology and epidemiology part. What is the role of imaging modalities then? Imaging modalities are not used primarily for the diagnosis of COVID-19 disease. The diagnosis is achieved by doing the RT-PCR. Now, imaging findings or imaging investigations like chest X-rays or HRCT, they may help us to assess the severity of the disease, to assess the various complications related to COVID-19 disease. Now, broadly speaking, what is the imaging pattern which is predominantly seen in COVID-19 patients? It has been described as the imaging spectrum of atypical pneumonia or organizing pneumonia pattern which is seen. What does this mean? We are going to discuss it in detail as we go ahead. So that is the role of imaging modalities. Because it is going to involve the lung, obviously chest X-ray is something that we must discuss. Though chest X-ray or a chest radiograph is one of the very important modalities to assess the lungs, no doubt it can readily be done, right? In COVID-19 disease, it does not have a very important or a major role to play. Why is it so? It is so because it is not very sensitive to pick up the lung changes that occur in this disease. It is normal in most of the early cases. Even as the disease progresses, right, the imaging findings which are seen on a chest radiograph are not very prominently seen on a chest X-ray. However, in very advanced cases, when the lung involvement becomes diffuse or extensive, you might see a few findings, and these findings are mainly airspace opacities like consolidations, ground glass opacities. It is usually peripheral and lower zone involvement which is seen. Yes, one important role that chest radiograph has is that once an HRCT is done, the patient is a known case of COVID-19 with lung changes. What is done is that chest radiographs can be used to follow up these patients, monitor the progression of the disease or lung involvement. So that is an important role of chest radiographs. If chest radiographs don't play a very important role, then which is that imaging modality which is the best for evaluation of the lung involvement in COVID-19? Yes, you guessed it right. So the imaging investigation of choice in COVID-19 disease is high resolution CT scan of the lung or HRCT. So we are going to have an in-depth discussion about the HRCT spectrum of findings. When do we do an HRCT? If you look at the indications. Now, if you have a suspected COVID-19 patient with only mild clinical features, right, HRCT is not done or it is not indicated. A suspected COVID-19 patient with moderate to severe clinical features and a high pretest probability of having the disease in HRCT is indicated. Yes. And of course, a confirmed COVID-19 patient with worsening respiratory status, you need to do an HRCT. So your examiner could ask you a question, which of these is an indication or which of these is not an indication? And therefore, we need to know what are the exact indications for doing an HRCT. Now, see, before we go to discuss in depth about the HRCT findings, let us have a conceptual discussion as to the various findings which can be seen on HRCT. Because the lung is going to be involved, right, the lung appearance is going to change. When the lung density increases, it may give rise to two types of opacities. One is a ground glass type of opacity, one is a consolidation. Let us discuss them. Before we go there, look at this HRCT. This is how a normal lung usually appears. You can see the appearance of the lungs, right? In the right and left hemithoraces. So the lung has a very dark gray or more or less a black kind of an appearance. These white dots or white lines that you see in the lung fields, these are usually the blood vessels which are there. Now, when the lung density increases, it may give rise to an opacity which is called as ground glass opacity. Look at the HRCT there. Can you see in the image that the yellow arrows are pointing towards an area of increased density? This is what is called as ground glass. So what is ground glass? By definition, ground glass opacity is defined as an hazy increase in lung density without obscuration of the underlying blood vessels. So look carefully at the areas to which the yellow arrows are pointing. Can you see some white dots or lines inside that particular area? Yes. So what are those? Those are blood vessels, and the increased density or haziness is not obscuring those blood vessels. So you're able to see those blood vessels clearly. And therefore, this is what is called as a ground glass opacity. Did you get that? A picture is worth a thousand words, they say. And here you can see whatever I've just described here. So this is what is ground glass opacity. Now, when there is a very severe increase in the density of the lungs, then what happens? The entire involved part of the lung, it appears white. Look at the red arrow where it is pointing. It is densely opaque. Now, can you see any white lines or dots within that particular involved area of lung? No, in the normal lung around it, you can see that. But in the involved area, you're not able to see that, right? So what is consolidation? It is a marked increase in the density of the lung with obscuration of the underlying blood vessels. Now, the blood vessels are not seen in that involved area, but can you see a few branching black lines there? What are those? Those are the bronchi in that particular area. And what you see here is nothing but a sign which is called as air bronchogram sign. Alright, so this is what is the basic difference between ground glass opacity and consolidation. Did you get that? Let us have a look again. Look at this HRCT image. The blue arrow is pointing towards normal lung, in which the blood vessels are very well seen, the normal dark gray or a black appearance of the lung. The red arrow is pointing towards an area of consolidation, which is a very, very severe increase or marked increase in the lung density, or it is causing an opacity. Underlying blood vessels are not seen, but you can see black lines, that is air bronchogram. So red arrow is pointing towards consolidation. Around the area of consolidation, you can see a haziness, right? This is called ground glass opacity, because through that, into that haziness, you are able to see the vascular markings. So in this image, this is a very beautiful image. I hope you appreciate the findings. This is how a normal lung consolidation ground glass opacity looks like. Now, why have I gone into so much depth? You'll realize in the next 2 minutes. As far as the HRCT findings of COVID-19 disease are concerned, the findings can be divided into 4 groups. Group 1 is preclinical, and then first week, second week, third week after onset. This is how the disease usually progresses. Let us look at them one by one. In group 1, that is preclinical stage, the patient is yet asymptomatic. It is yet to have any, you know, respiratory complaints, but the test has come positive, and across various studies that have been done, right, once the HRCT was done in this particular stage, what did they see? They saw predominantly unilateral, multifocal, that is multiple areas of ground glass pacification. Do you realize now why we have gone into the depth of ground glass opacification and how it looks? Because ground glass opacification is a very, very important imaging finding which is seen in COVID-19 disease. So look at this CT here. I've said predominantly unilaterals, though in this patient you can see that there are areas of ground glass opacities bilaterally. It is predominantly on one side, more on one side, and it is a hazy increase in density with underlying blood vessels visible, so it is ground glass opacity. So this is what is stage 1. Then what will happen in stage 2? The involvement will become slightly more diffuse. So in group 2, that is the first week after the onset of the disease, you will see bilateral diffuse subpleural ground glass opacification. This terminology is very, very important. This is a very classical pattern. What is that? It is bilateral involvement, diffuse involvement. Where, which lung is involved? Is it the central lung? No, it is peripheral or subpleural, just beneath the pleura, ground glass opacification occurs. This may be accompanied with septal thickening. Septal thickening, these are lung septae. When it gets thickened, it appears as lines, right, within the lung fields, thickened inter and interlobular septa. Again, this creates a named appearance. This is what is called as the crazy paving pattern. This, look at this HRCT image. You can see the yellow arrows are pointing where they are pointing towards the peripheral lung field, subpleural. Bilateral involvement, diffuse involvement, and if you look at the opacity, underlying blood vessels are visible. So this is ground glass opacification, isn't it? So this is a very, very classical CT image. Once you look at the CT image, especially in these times, or even up to the next 1 year, you know, you look at, you come across such an imaging pattern with a respiratory illness kind of a presentation, you must think of COVID-19. Then as the disease progresses, now see in group 1 or as well as group 2, the predominant imaging finding is ground glass opacity. But in group 3, along with ground glass opacities, consolidation begins to occur. So your examiner may ask you, consolidation appears when? It appears in group 3, that is around the second week from the onset of clinical disease. So still the predominant finding is diffuse ground glass opacification, right? But now consolidation begins to appear. Look at the HRCT image. The yellow arrows are pointing at haziness with blood vessels seen, that is ground glass opacities. Inside it, you can see on the right side, the red arrow, it is pointing towards consolidation. So consolidation appears in group 3, that is second week from onset. Pleural effusion lymphadenopathy may also be seen in this particular stage. Then as the disease progresses, there is ground glass opacification, there is consolidation, there is reticular pattern. So this reticular pattern basically implies lung fibrosis. This fibrosis suggests that there is some interstitial changes. This may be permanent, right? These patients need to be followed up. Because there is fibrosis, there is traction bronchiectasis. Look at the right lung field. You can see a round black area in the area of consolidation there. So there is traction bronchiectasis which occurs. Pleural effusion lymphadenopathy may also be seen. So that is how the imaging findings are going to progress from just patchy ground glass opacity, unilateral in group 1, bilateral diffuse subpleural involvement in group 2, consolidation begins to appear in group 3, and it becomes extremely diffuse along with interstitial changes and fibrosis in group 4. So this is how the disease progresses on HRCT. Now, there is a typical imaging sign which has been described in invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, and that is called as halo sign. What is that halo sign? Halo sign, if you remember, is a central area of consolidation surrounded by ground glass opacity around it. That is called halo sign. So what will be reverse halo? Reverse halo is when there is a central area of ground glass opacification with a rim of consolidation around it. Traditionally, typically, reverse halo sign, or also called as a tall sign, has been described in cases of organizing pneumonia. Right? Do you get a link? But at the start of this particular session, I told you what is the predominant imaging pattern in COVID-19 disease. It is atypical or organizing pneumonia. And therefore, this reverse halo sign or a tall sign may also be seen in COVID-19 disease. So there are a few peculiarities that you need to remember about COVID-19 disease. Do you remember? We have discussed bilateral, peripheral, subpleural, diffuse ground glass opacity 1. crazy pavement appearance we have discussed. Here we are again discussing another typical named appearance, and that is reverse halo sign or atoll sign, which may also be seen in COVID-19 disease or pneumonia. Recently, they have come up with a CT involvement score. What is this? Try to understand. Look at the table there. What we need to assess is how much percentage of each lobe of lung is involved. So both lungs, if you consider together, there are five lobes, right? So right upper lobe, right middle lobe, right lower lobe, three lobes on the right side, two lobes, left upper lobe, left lower lobe on the left side. So now you use a scoring scale that you can see on the screen there. If absolutely no involvement of a lobe is there, then you assess the score of 0. If less than 5%, score is 1. 5 to 25% score is 2. 25 to 50 score is 3. Right? 50 to 75, 4. More than 75% involvement of a lobe, score is 5. So each lobe you give a score and then you add them up. So there is no involvement, each lobe will have a score of 0. So total CT involvement score in COVID-19 patient would be 0. If 100% lobes are involved, right, both lungs are involved, each of the lobe will be assigned a score of 5. If more than 75% involvement is seen, so the total score will be 25. So the CT involvement score will have a range of around 0 to 25. So this is about the CT involvement score. Then, based upon BI-RADS, if you've seen my breast imaging lectures on the Marrow app, we've discussed in depth about BI-RADS. What is BI-RADS? It is breast imaging reporting and data system. So similarly, now in order to create a standardized approach, right, throughout the world, because almost every country in the world has been affected, so everywhere CT scans are going to be done. So to reduce the inter-observer variability, to bring in a standardization of the descriptive terminology, they have introduced a CORADS. So what is CORADS? CORADS is COVID-19 reporting and data system. The categories, if you see, they are very, very similar to BI-RADS. So in BI-RADS also, we started with, we started with 0 and went to 6. Here we start with 1 and go to 6. So what is CORADS 1? So CORADS 1 is highly unlikely. So the CT scan is more or less normal. CORADS 2 is also unlikely, because the abnormality that you see on a CT scan is that which is not suggestive or not consistent with COVID-19, but it suggests some other type of disease. CORADS 3 is equivocal, because it is unclear whether COVID-19 would be present or not. CORADS 4 is probable, yes, because abnormalities are suspicious. You see ground glass opacities, you see crazy paving pattern, you see reverse halo sign, right? CORADS 5 is highly likely. Whatever CT, HRCT images that I've shown you until now, right, these, if you see any such findings, if you see bilateral, diffuse, subpleural, ground glass opacification in a patient presenting with fever and respiratory complaints in these days, you have to think of, you know, COVID-19. So such a patient will fall into what category? It will fall into CORADS 5. Highly likely. If you're doing a CT scan in a patient who is already tested positive on RT-PCR for COVID disease, then you categorize that patient as CORADS 6. That is a PCR proven case. So this is just to bring about a standardization in reporting. This is what is called as CORADS. Now, what role does ultrasound has to play? Ultrasound can basically be used for follow-up of patients to see whether there is pleural effusion. We have discussed a concept, fluid is friend of ultrasound, right? So to detect whether there is pleural effusion, right, patient is worsening as far as the respiratory status is concerned. If there is effusion, you can aspirate that fluid, so that that will help the lungs to expand. Patient's respiratory status might improve. So ultrasound has a role to play there. What findings are seen on ultrasound? See, there are multiple B lines which could be seen, and there is another typical name sign which has been described on lung ultrasound, and that is what is called as the light beam sign. Look at the ultrasound image on the screen there. You can see two vertical white lines or reverberation artifacts which are pointed by the red arrows there. This is what is called as the light beam sign. And because the consolidations which are there are peripheral in the lung fields, right, the ultrasound probe which is kept on the chest wall, right, it will be able to pick up these peripheral subpleural consolidations. The most important role, however, for that ultrasound plays in COVID-19 disease is to detect the presence of pleural effusions that can be aspirated, that may help the patient. So let's revise quickly. These are all potential MCQs that could be asked in your exams. What is the most common imaging finding overall that you find in COVID-19 disease? It is bilateral, subpleural, diffuse, multifocal, ground glass opacification. So this is the most common imaging finding overall if they ask you. If they ask you what is the most common imaging finding in early stages, the answer remains the same. What is that? It is bilateral, subpleural, multifocal, ground glass opacification. Now, if they specifically ask you, look at the CT image there. All the yellow arrows are pointing to ground glass opacities, predominantly in the peripheral lung, subpleural location. If they ask you, what is the most common imaging finding in late stages? Then from group 3 to group 4, what appears? There is consolidation that appears. So multifocal consolidations and crazy paving pattern. Look at the CT, multiple yellow arrows there pointing towards focal consolidations, multifocal consolidations. So in early stages, it is diffuse ground glass opacification. In late stages, it progresses to consolidation. What is the most common lobe affected for mechanisms which are not entirely known till date? Right, the most common lobe which is involved in COVID-19 disease is right lower lobe. Remember, see all these findings that we have discussed. This is something that I have compiled from the various studies which are conducted across the world, which have been published till date as of the date of recording this video, and that is around 8th of June. Right, however, as we go ahead, new studies may come along, new patterns may be identified, and maybe if you look at this video right in the year or later part of 2020 or maybe in 2021, then you might find new changes because it is still an evolving process. So let us look at the few important MCQs that you could be asked. So what is the most common imaging finding which is seen in early cases of COVID-19 disease? So early cases of COVID-19 disease, if they ask you, remember, the answer is going to be multifocal subpleural ground glass opacities. So that is going to be the answer to this particular question. If they ask you what is the most common imaging finding seen in COVID-19 disease, so overall they are asking you again, as I said, most common imaging finding overall as well as in the early stages is again same multifocal subpleural ground glass opacification. Yes, but if they ask you what is the most common imaging finding in late stages of COVID-19 disease, then the answer is going to be consolidation, because as the disease progresses in the early stages, there is ground glass opacity. in group 3, and then in group 4 you see multifocal consolidation. So in late stages, most common imaging finding is consolidation. Yes, so that is the answer A here in this particular question. Most common lobe of lung which is involved in COVID-19 disease is right lower lobe. We have discussed that already. So imaging investigation of choice for COVID-19 disease, we have discussed, chest x-ray is normal in most of the cases. It has poor sensitivity. Ultrasound can be used for follow-up of known cases, right, to look for pleural effusions. Mainly MRI has no role in lung imaging till date, so HRCT of the lung is the imaging investigation of choice for COVID-19 disease. Imaging findings seen in COVID-19 disease is our reverse halo sign or a tall sign is seen in organizing pneumonia. A typical pneumonia or organizing pneumonia is broadly the imaging pattern which is seen in COVID-19 disease. So yes, light beam sign, if you remember, I showed you an image on ultrasound image, light beam sign, two white lines of reverberation artifacts are seen. Crazy paving pattern is because of interstitial thickening. So interlobular or intralobular septal thickening that occurs within the lungs, usually from group 3 onwards as fibrosis sets in, group 2, group 3 onwards, right? So that is what is called crazy paving pattern. All of these we've discussed. So these are just few named signs that you'll come across in COVID-19 disease. So therefore, the answer to this particular question is all of the above. Yes. CORADS category that is highly suggestive of COVID-19 disease is CORADS 5. So highly suggestive, very typical imaging pattern is CORADS 5. We have discussed this. Yes. Light beam sign on ultrasound is seen in COVID-19 disease. Yes. So what is light beam sign? We've seen an image as well. Most common imaging findings seen in early cases of COVID-19 disease. This is just a repeat question. It is again multifocal subpleural ground glass opacity. I've just put it so that you can get it emphasized in your heads. Yes. Now friends, before I conclude with this particular video, I want to comment a bit on a very, very important aspect that is going to help you in your exam preparation. The AIIMS exams, JIPMER exams are just, you know, your other important central institute exams, they are just a few days away. This is a very difficult time for PG aspirants, right? There's a lot of stress, there are a lot of distractions, right? Traveling issues, you go to a new place, all this pandemic fear mongering is going along, and there is a sense of self-doubt, fear, anxiety that sometimes creeps in. How to overcome that? I'm just going to put up a very short story which will help you overcome this particular phobia. You know, once there was a businessman, a very successful one, who ran a successful business, but over the years, you know, his business ran into a lot of troubles. Debts kept on increasing, right? Revenues went on dropping. He lost major contracts. He had a lot of liabilities on his head, a lot of staff payments, a lot of loans. So one fine day, after many years of struggling, you know, his company collapsed. He was almost on the brink of bankruptcy. He was sitting on a bench, you know, with, you know, his head in his hands, and, you know, he was about to give up. At that point, you know, he had a small tap on his shoulder. He looked back, there was an old man. The old man asked him, "What is your problem?" He said, "I am in a lot of loss. I don't think I'll be able to survive this crisis. My business has tanked. I have a lot of liabilities, payments to be made. I don't think I'll come out of this." The old man said, "Today is your lucky day. I'm here to help you." "How?" He said, "I have a bit of money of my own that I'm not using. I can lend that money to you. I'll give you, say, $1 million, he said. "For a year though, I am loaning it to you. After 1 year, we meet here at the same place in this same garden at this particular bench and you give my money back to me." The man was very happy, right? It was God sent. The gift was God sent, right? So he took a check of around $1 million from that particular old man, went to his home in a relieved state of mind. Next morning, he thought he'll encash that check. But before he did that, he thought, "Let me keep this check in a safe, right, for a day or so." He said, "I have this check anyways to fall back upon. Let me see what I can do with my business. He took it up as a challenge. You know, anyways, at the back of the mind, he always knew he had that particular check with him, which he could encash any time. So he went to his, you know, clients. He renegotiated the payment terms with them. He went to his staff, shared all his plight with them. Right, made some payment extensions. He went to his banks, put up his business propositions, took a few of his loans. Gradually, very slowly, and it was not at all easy, he made his business move. He started working. He got a small contract. Right, he worked on it. He got some amount of revenue. Some payments of his staffs were done. So he worked hard day and night. Got a few more contracts, signed a few more deals, renegotiated a few contracts. Money began to flow in, right? He cleared his due payments, interests were paid off. He expanded his company, acquired a new one, you know, got new contracts, you know, went overseas, bought in new customers. You know, within 6 months of time, he was out of all his debt and doing extremely well. Within a year of time, his company had grown at least 2 to 3 times. He was so happy, and this was all because of that one check that he had got. He was very happy, took that check out from the safe. He had not encashed it, remember. Went to that same garden, sat on the same bench, and to his surprise, the old man came there, right? The old man took his check, you know, back from that particular man. At that very moment, something very absurd happened. A nurse came running, right? Few hospital guys came running, caught hold of that old man and said to that particular young business fellow, he said, "I'm sorry if this man has troubled you. This is an inmate of a nearby mental hospital who just slips away. Tells people he is a very rich man, hands over fake checks. We are sorry if he has inconvenienced you in any way." They took the old man away in an ambulance to a mental asylum nearby. The businessman was shocked. He just sat there, stunned. He realized at that very moment that that old man, just by handing him over that one piece of paper of supposedly $1 million, right, had completely turned around his life. What was the reason? He had not encashed that check. That check was just in a safe, right? And just the feeling of security that he had, the confidence that he had, that he has that check to fall back upon eventually, you know, made him work harder, made him, you know, search for solutions. He could turn around his entire fortune. All I want you to believe and remember today is that you have this check of $1 million with you. Rather, you have something greater than that. You have all that information in your head, whatever you have read throughout the year, whatever you have studied. It is all there inside your head. All you need to believe is that it is there. It is there for you to fall back upon. You can rely on it. On the day of your exam and the countdown to it, the next few days are going to be stressful. All I want you to do is to remind yourself about this $1 million check story. I want you to remind yourself that you have all that information in your brain. On the day of the exam, wake up and tell yourself, this is your day to perform. You've done everything that you could have. You've worked hard throughout the past 1 year or so, right? You've left no stone unturned, and now is your time to perform. Now is your time to supposedly encash that check. Just believe in yourself. Go into the exam. Your brain will automatically start working. Circuits will open up. Your brain will be able to solve those difficult questions that otherwise you would have been afraid of, right? All I want you to do is to believe in yourself. Believe that there's something inside you which is far, far greater than the obstacles or the hurdles or the distractions which are there around you right now. So just give your best shot and get that coveted seat, get that glorified success. Friends, this is one of my first attempts to make such a video, so there might be some glitches that you would find in these ones. But do tell me whether you liked this video, whether you like the content. Just tell me whether there would be any other topics that you want me to discuss as we go ahead, so I would be able to work on it and come up with such videos. Tell me how you like this video and my new look as well. I'm waiting to hear from you. All the very best. Let's rock radiology together. Thank you very much.